Hey everyone, today I want to talk about a pattern in iOS called dependency injection, and it's been by far one of the most important patterns I've learned in my career, and it helps you write code that is loosely coupled, flexible, and easily testable. Let's see how it works. Alright, so dependency injection is just a fancy term for this idea that if you have an object that relies on other things to function, that object should receive those dependencies as input and should not be in charge of creating those dependencies itself. So consider this view controller that relies on classes for managing network requests, data persistence, and the user's location. We know that one of the main goals when we're developing software is to create classes and components that are loosely coupled and flexible. But we can see here that this view controller has completely missed the mark. Firstly, any class that uses this view controller has no idea what dependencies it has. Everything is sort of happening under the hood. Secondly, we wouldn't even be able to swap out any of these classes for their subclasses if we wanted to. And what if Network Manager had dependencies of its own that view controller had to provide? For example, you know, parameter 1, parameter 2, and so on. If the view controller had to instantiate all of these objects and satisfy all of their dependencies, very quickly this view controller's responsibilities become unmanageable, and there's no way that we'd be able to reuse any of the code here. And that's exactly the problem that dependency injection solves. So let's refactor this to use dependency injection instead. All right, so after refactoring this to use dependency injection, we have something like this instead. And you can see that the implementation is not too different. The only main addition is the introduction of this init function that takes in as parameters all of the dependencies that ViewController has. And a few other things to call out is that now our actual references to these dependencies can be private and they can be immutable because they are passed in as input to this ViewController. And now we can just go ahead and create an instance of this ViewController in this way. And with this approach, our solution is much more flexible and transparent because I can pass in Network Manager or any of its subclasses, Data Manager or any of its subclasses, and so on. And anyone that's using this view controller can now better understand the responsibilities of this class, and it eliminates the hidden dependencies problem that we had before. But we are just scratching the surface here. All right, so I've gone ahead and I've created some new subclasses for testing different network conditions, changing how the data is stored, and changing where the user location information is coming from. So with our new approach, we could drop any of these into our view controller without having to change any of the logic inside. So for example, we could do something like this. Right? We can pass Network Manager or any of its subclasses in as input, in as the dependencies, and view controller is none the wiser. And since the view controller no longer knows exactly what objects are being passed in, any subclass or anything that implements the correct protocol is fair game. So with a simple change by passing in the dependencies, we've greatly extended the view controller's reusability and made it far more testable and extensible. If we had kept the initial approach where we were creating the network manager inside the view controller, our implementation would be extremely coupled with network manager, and we wouldn't be able to reuse any of this logic. Now we have way more options and our code is far more flexible. Let's look at some more examples. So we can easily use this pattern to create things like A/B test. So for example, let's say you wanted to see which pricing calculations lead to higher conversions on your app's checkout page. So for the same view controller, you can pass in different pricing calculation algorithms without having to change any of the underlying code in your checkout view controller. You couldn't do something like this if checkout view controller was initializing any of these services internally. Or similarly, if you were doing like some testing in your app, and you could easily create a custom development flow for testing special behavior, right? You could simulate a user being logged in or the actual login flow, depending on what you need at the time. And as a side note, dependency injection and the coordinator pattern pair really well together, and I'll have a video on the coordinator pattern up very soon. The other main advantage of dependency injection is how testable it makes your code base. Dependency injection makes it very easy to replace an object's dependency with mock objects, which makes unit tests easier to set up and allows us to isolate behavior. So I've gone ahead and I've created two subclasses on Network Manager, and one simulates a real HTTP request and the other one fakes it entirely. So imagine that this is like a real URL session task and that this is all legit. In this one, I have it intentionally return hard-coded text. And that's because you want your test to be deterministic. You want the same input to always give you the same output. And when you write your test, you want to be testing things in isolation. So if we were writing a test for view controller and we were using the real network manager, what we are actually testing is a view controller plus the network manager, not just the view controller on its own. So that's why I've created this mock network manager. And because we're using dependency injection, I can easily swap it out here for network manager without having to change any of the code in view controller. And view controller really doesn't even know that it's getting a different object. It doesn't know whether it's getting the original network manager or any of its subclasses. And this allows us to test the behavior of view controller in isolation just on its own. And the only other change that I've made to this class is I've gone ahead and I've created these two properties just to get this example here to compile. And just simply by passing in these dependencies rather than having them initialized internally, the ViewController class becomes way more modular and testable. I could have done the exact same thing for the data manager and the location manager to test how the UI or the app responds to different data changes or user location changes. What I've shown you so far is a type of dependency injection called initializer injection. And there are a few different ways of implementing dependency injection, but the version I've shown you so far is the recommended approach. You can also inject dependencies by creating a special function to pass in the dependencies. So we can go ahead and implement that really quickly. And we can get rid of this init and this. And this approach requires us making all of these vars instead of lets, and these are all optional. So now here, when we go to run this view controller, we can say something like this, and then we have the same options as before. We can just pass in the dependencies in this way. Now, this is useful if you're working with view controllers that you're loading from storyboard, that kind of thing. But the downside is that you have to remember to call this function wherever you are loading a view controller, right? And you have to make these properties both variables and optionals, right? Instead of lets. So you are no longer having that immutability that you had with initializer injection. All right, and the final variation on dependency injection is called property injection, which just means setting the properties directly from the calling class. So we'll get rid of this method here. We'll get rid of these private declarations. All right. And then here, instead of inject dependencies, we would just specify each of these properties manually. Now, this approach has the same issue as the previous one, because you might forget to set these properties, which could lead to a crash or unexpected behavior. And it also requires you to keep these properties public, and you have to make them mutable, which is not ideal. So there is flexibility in which variation of dependency injection you choose, but they're all working towards the same goal. So I hope you enjoyed the video. If you have any video requests, please leave it in the comment section below. Otherwise, please like, comment, and subscribe. Thanks.